Hello again, everyone. Welcome to Scripture Verse by Verse. My name is Michael Moret. We're in the book of Matthew today. We're in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, and we resume our study in verse 21. Actually, yeah, we're in Matthew chapter 17, verse 22. And so grab your Bible, open it up to the Gospel of Matthew, and we'll begin in a minute. Scripture Verse by Verse is a ministry that I began a little over 30 years ago. It began with one secular AM station, and I felt that God was calling me to teach the Word of God on radio at that particular time. I was saved listening to Christian radio, and even I was listening to a lot of Christian programs on secular radio back in those days, believe it or not. So I felt that that played such an important part in my salvation that I needed to do the same thing, and that's what God called me to do. So I got a great deal on some broadcast equipment from a radio station. I set up a studio in my home, and then I needed to find a radio station. So I went to the library, and I looked up a list of all the radio stations in Wisconsin, and there was a lot of them. And I didn't know where to start. I didn't know what to do, you know, so I just prayed over all those stations, and I picked one, trusted that God led me, and I took a ride over to the station. It was probably about 80 miles away from my house, and I made an appointment. I sat down with the station manager, and I told him who I was and what I wanted to do, and he proceeded to give me a year's worth of airtime for free. And this was a secular, it was a country and western station. A year's worth of airtime for free. And I learned in the last 30 years that's a very rare thing. Most, you know, radio stations charge you $2.50 or so a minute. And that includes Christian stations to be on the air, to broadcast a program. So it's a costly thing. So God really blessed me and got me started, and that was over 30 years ago. And I've been teaching the Word of God verse by verse ever since. And 30 years of archive can be found at thebibleversebyverse.com, where you can study those early messages and all of them in between for the last 30 years, going through the Bible three times, verse by verse, using my audio Bible commentaries. Again, that's at thebibleversebyverse.com. But as I said, we're in Matthew chapter 17, verse 22. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that you would sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Verse 22. And while they abode in Galilee, Jesus said unto them, the Son of Man shall be betrayed into the hands of men. Now, here's another bombshell. Jesus had begun to mention to these guys, his apostles, that he was going to die and that he would be raised on the third day. And that was a shocker to them. And here he adds something else to the story. He had not said up until this time, as far as we know, that he was going to be betrayed and then murdered. So this just makes it even worse. They must have been absolutely shocked to hear about that. Jesus would be betrayed. You know, normally, in order to be betrayed, a person has to be tricked. But you can't trick God, and you can't trick Jesus because he is God. So he's going to allow himself to be betrayed so that he can die on the cross, pay for our sins. Verse 23. And he continues, and they shall kill him. Stop there for a second. They shall kill him. You know, Jesus didn't always say happy things. And the reason he didn't always say happy things is because he spoke the truth. And some truth is not pleasant to hear. And we are living in a day and age where people, for the most part, don't want to hear negative things. They want to go to a church that preaches happy things, positive things. Those are the extremely big churches today. Those are the ones where the preachers are multimillionaires. They have a positive ministry, they say. Well, yeah, you know what? I'm positive about something too. I'm positive they're in it for the money. I'm positive they have a positive ministry, and that's why they, by their own admission, don't talk about sin, don't talk about repentance, don't talk about hell, don't talk about judgment, don't talk about any of that stuff, because they have a positive ministry, and they're positive that they want to be multimillionaires, and they are. And it's all a scam. It's all a sham. They're hirelings, not preachers. But you know what? That's what people want today. Many people will not go, many people will not go near a preacher who speaks the truth when it is negative. Many people don't want to hear negative things. That's understandable. Who wants to hear stuff like Jesus just said? He's going to be betrayed and then he's going to be killed. Who wants to hear stuff like that? Nobody wants to hear that. That's understandable. But to avoid a preacher who preaches the truth in its entirety simply because some parts are negative, that's not understandable. And for a preacher to skip preaching things that are negative in the Word of God, that's not understandable times infinity. Because then you're withholding truth from people who need to hear it. And worst of all, you are not giving people the whole counsel of God, even though Jesus did. That's inexcusable. So verse 23 again. And they shall kill him, and the third day he shall be raised again. And they were exceeding sorry. The disciples were so horrified from the bombshell that Jesus was going to be betrayed and murdered that I think this whole deal about him being raised again on the third day flew right over their head. They didn't even hear that part. They were still in shock from the first part, which is why none of them were ready for the resurrection on Easter Sunday morning. They were all caught by surprise. Well, why? It's not because Jesus didn't tell them about it more than once. It just didn't click with them. Verse 24. And when they were come to Capernaum, they that received tribute money came to Peter and said, "Doth not your master pay tribute?" And the tribute here is a tax. And it's not a Roman tax. It is a Jewish tax. It is a temple tax that the Hebrews were required to pay regularly for the upkeep of the temple. And so somebody comes up to Peter and says, "Peter, doesn't your master pay the temple tax?" Well, look at verse 25. Well, actually, look at verse 24 again. When they come to Capernaum, they that received tribute money came to Peter and said, "Doth not your master pay tribute?" 25. He saith, "Yes," and stop right there. Peter just spoke with authority about something that he had absolutely no knowledge of at all. And what made matters worse is that it involved Almighty God. It is never smart to make an empty, authoritative statement. It is never smart to speak with authority about something that you don't have any idea what you're talking about. That is always wrong. That is always dangerous. Multiply it times infinity when it involves God or God's word. Never, ever speak with authority about something in God's word if you don't know for certain that it is true. Never be afraid to say, "I don't know, but I'll do some research and I'll let you know as soon as I find out." A holy Christian, an on-fire Christian who loves Jesus, doesn't mind saying, "I don't know, but I can find out." So Peter I like Peter, you know, and I think he gets a bum rap a lot of times from people today. People laugh at him, people pick on him, but one thing that he was guilty of doing more than once is just speaking off the top of his head with authority about things that he was clueless about. And this was one of them. It was dangerous because he presumed to speak for Jesus. You never want to presume to speak for anyone. You certainly never want to presume to speak for Almighty God. Oh, you better not. So, verse 25, he said, yes, well, of course, yes, yes, he pays the temple tax. And when he was come into the house, Jesus anticipated him, saying, what thinkest thou, Simon? Of whom did the kings of the earth take custom or tribute, of their own children or of strangers? Jesus was not there when Peter was asked the question. He was not there when he gave the answer. There's absolutely no indication that he knew or that anybody told him about these things. And yet, when he saw Peter the next time, he immediately goes up to him and he confronts him concerning the question, concerning the answer that Peter gave. Jesus knew all about the question and the answer. And he wastes no time in confronting Peter. Verse 25 and 26. So he saith, yes. And when he was come into the house, Jesus anticipated him, saying, what thinkest thou, Simon? Of whom do the kings of the earth take custom or tribute? Of their own children or of strangers? Peter saith unto them, of strangers. Jesus saith unto him, then the children are free. They're exempt. And that's true. No member of any royal family has to pay taxes to their dad. They're part of the royal family. You see where Jesus is going with this? Jesus is saying, Peter, I don't have to pay taxes for the upkeep of my dad's house. I'm part of the royal family. You wouldn't do that to some other royal family member. Now, Jesus didn't drill Peter. He didn't make him feel small for what he said, but he did make it clear that Peter answered incorrectly. And you got to be careful about doing that at any time, but especially when you're talking about God, you know, very, very careful not to do that. 27. Notwithstanding, Jesus said, lest we should offend them, go thou to the sea and cast an hook. Go fishing, Peter. I want you to go fishing. And Peter's got to be thinking, what does this have to do with the topic, right? But Jesus says, go fishing, throw in a hook, throw in your line, throw in a hook, and take up the first fish that cometh up. And when thou hast opened his mouth, thou shalt find a piece of money. That take and give unto them for me and for thee. Isn't this great? Jesus tells Peter to go fishing. The first fish that he catches, when you take the hook off, look in his mouth because there's going to be a coin. You can pay the taxes with that. How remarkable is that? Out of all the fish in the world, out of all the fish in that lake, Jesus would make sure that Peter caught the one that had either swallowed a coin or Jesus and he created one. Let's say he swallowed it. So Jesus is not a counterfeiter, okay? But isn't that something? What a miracle that was. You know, when it is God's will for us to do something, he's going to make a way for us to do it. And Jesus says, you know, we don't have to do this, but we're going to do it anyway to avoid looking bad to the world. So we're going to do it. Now, it is wrong to disobey God in any way in order to avoid looking bad to the unsaved. Because a lot of times, things that we say today, if you're faithful to the Word of God, are going to seem to be bad in the eyes of the unsaved world, because the unsaved world has gone downhill so quickly. I mean, when I was a kid, when I was a child back in the 60s, there were very few people that were antagonistic toward the written Word of God, even if they weren't saved. Even just members, people of the world, knew right from wrong, and they recognized that it was right to do what was right and good in the eyes of God. And they had respect for the Word of God, even if they were not saved. It's not that way today. Today, I stand up and I say homosexuality is a sin. Today, I stand up and I say that homosexuals are going to go to hell, along with liars and adulterers and fornicators. They're all wrong. They're all sin. If you don't repent and have those sins forgiven, you're going to go to hell. I stand up and say that. I'm called a hater. I'm very unpopular. I'm called unloving. Do you think that I refrain from saying those things because the world will get angry at me? Or even lukewarm Christians will get angry at me? No. I can't avoid speaking the truth simply because the unsaved will be angry at me or not be pleased with me. We can't avoid doing the correct thing simply because the unsaved world will be upset with us if we do the correct thing. So, but in this case, Jesus did the correct thing because it wasn't against the word of God to do what he did. He did not want to dishonor God, or he didn't want to be looked at as being bad in the eyes of the world because of not paying the taxes. And it didn't go against God's word to do it, so he did it. He did it. Then verse 27 again. Notwithstanding, lest we should be offended, and lest we should offend them, go thou to the sea and cast an hook, and take up the fish that first cometh up. And when thou hast opened his mouth, thou shalt find a piece of money. That take and give unto them for me and thee. And as I mentioned a few minutes ago, when it is God's will for us to do something, he will give us the grace and the means to do it. He will give us the means to do what he wants us to do. But he doesn't always do it in a conventional way. That's something to keep in mind. Normally, God provides money through a paycheck. Or if it's a minister, through an offering. But if through no fault of our own, that doesn't provide what we need to do what he wants us to do, then he will provide in some other way. Just depends on the circumstances. You know, the Israelites were fed manna for 40 years, every day, except Sabbath. They were given manna, food from heaven, every day, until they crossed the Jordan River and they entered the Promised Land. That day, the manna ceased because they were able to eat from the land, fruits and vegetables and grain. Let's go into chapter 18. At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now, I am thinking that their motives were probably selfish, but it was a good question, and I'm glad that they asked it. And I say that because if they don't ask this question, then maybe we don't get a clear definition of greatness the way God defines it. We must know how God defines great. We must know what God wants before we can do what God wants. And that's another very important reason to study Scripture. You're never going to understand what God wants you to do unless you read the Bible. Because you're never going to be able to do what God wants you to do unless you know what God wants you to do. And so I'm glad they asked this question. Look at verses 1 and 2. At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them. In order to illustrate greatness in the eyes of God, Jesus needs to use a little child, which probably was a shocker to the apostles. Conventional wisdom probably would have suggested that Jesus call a Pharisee, one of the religious rulers. But again, in order to illustrate greatness, Jesus called a little child. He didn't call for a Pharisee with their long flowing religious robes, although most people, again, thought the Pharisees were great. Others thought the scribes were great because they had memorized so much of Scripture, but Jesus didn't call for a scribe to come to his side either. God judges greatness by how genuinely humble we are. And that's why Christ called for a child. Verse 3. And said, Jesus said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. They wanted to know who is going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says, unless you be converted and become like little children, unless you change and become little, like little children, you're not even getting in. Forget about being the greatest. Which should tell us that the scribes and the Pharisees, who were haughty religious rulers, aren't even close to getting in the kingdom of heaven. But Jesus is saying, in essence, before you worry about being the greatest in the kingdom of God, make sure you get into the kingdom of God. Don't put the cart before the horse. Unless we repent and become like a child, we're not even getting into the kingdom of heaven. Verse 3. And said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. You know, Jesus said, become like a little child if you want to be great. Think about a child. Children know that they don't have what it takes to survive on their own. When they hurt themselves, what do? They start crying and they run to mom or dad. They want to be comforted. They want to be held. They want their mom and dad to fix it. When they're hungry, what do? They come to mom or dad. Little children trust their parents to take care of them. Little children are honest enough and humble enough to ask for help, to be saved. A sinner must know that they can never survive the day of judgment by their own merits. To be saved, a sinner must admit to God that they need help. As much as a little child needs help, they need help. To be saved, a sinner must be honest and humble enough to ask for God's help through the Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus is talking about when he says, unless you become like a little child, you can't even enter into the kingdom of God. Verse 4. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. The world defines greatness much differently than God. To the world, being great means being talented, or good-looking, or wealthy, or having a high IQ. None of those things are greatness to God. God would say, if you want to be great, don't be pushy. Don't act like you're better than others. Be willing to do the menial, servant-like jobs that many people think they're above doing. That's humility. And that's God's definition of greatness. Verse 5. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name receiveth me. Every time we are kind to a little child, we are being kind to Jesus. That's how Jesus sees it. A child is vulnerable. They're easily used and abused. And therefore, they have the special attention of God. When we do Jesus a personal favor, when we are kind to little children, because they are the most vulnerable. Verse 6, but whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Anyone who has the ability to influence children would be wise to influence them in the direction of Almighty God in the Lord Jesus Christ. those who poison the mind of children by removing the distinction between right and wrong, or by influencing them away from God through Jesus Christ, will suffer a horrible fate, horrible judgment from God. A person would be better off suffering a violent death than doing something to move a child away from Jesus Christ, contributing to the destruction of an innocent soul is a serious sin to Almighty God. Verse 7. Woe unto the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come. But woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. Temptations are a part of life in this sinful world. Consequently, people will sin. But God says, just make sure you're not the one doing the tempting. When God says, woe unto you if you do this or that, no amount of pleasure that you might receive from doing it is going to be worth the pain that you will suffer after you do it. It's bad to sin. It's even worse to drag others into it. You better be careful not to tempt others to sin. Verse 8. Wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life with one eye, rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. Nothing and no one is worth going to hell for. It's not even close. Sin is the reason people go to hell. So Jesus says, if something causes you to sin, stay away from it. And you know what? Hands, feet, and eyes are not used exclusively to commit sin. But if they can't be controlled and used only for good, then Jesus says, cut them off. You're better off living without the good that your hands and your feet and your eyes provide, if that's the only way to avoid sinning with them. And of course, Jesus is not talking about literal amputation here. But the point is this: many things are morally neutral, like eyes, like hands, like feet. They're morally neutral, and many things are morally neutral. We can use them for good, we can use them for bad. Don't keep something in your life that is used for good if you don't have the willpower to stop it from also being used to sin. The good that it does isn't worth going to hell for. Go without the good that it does to avoid the sin that you do with it, which will eventually send you to hell if it keeps you from Christ and from repenting. You know what? I'm going to stop right here. You can continue studying the Word of God, though, at thebibleversebyverse.com if you want to, and I hope you do. Just go to thebibleversebyverse.com and click on the book that you want to study. And if it's the first time you are visiting, I encourage you to go to the book of Genesis and click on that and click on chapter 1 and begin a verse-by-verse study. Begin in Genesis, in the beginning. Go all the way through the Bible, verse by verse, through the book of Revelation. And when you're done doing it the first time, do it the second time, and then do it the third time, because you can do it three times with three different series of going through the Bible verse by verse. That's at thebibleversebyverse.com. And if the Word of God is a blessing to you, remember, please, that I'm brought to you by your prayers and financial support. This is a faith ministry. It has been for 30 years, and I depend on individuals like you, not churches, not denominations, no no large corporation or anything like that underwriting this ministry. I depend on individuals who love the Word of God to give as the Lord may lead. So please pray for this ministry, and if the Lord shall lead you to give, you can give in a secure method at thebibleversebyverse.com by clicking on the donate button at the top of the front page. Thanks for spending this time with me. I do appreciate it, and I look forward to us getting together next time. Until then, Michael Moret for Scripture Verse by Verse. Remember, stay in the Word and stay in prayer. So long, everyone.